So, hello, hello there, and welcome back to War Thunder. And today, as you might see in the top left corner, I have the Drachinifel with me. The guy being famous for his 5-minute guides and his in-depth, you know, discussions about anything regarding naval combat from the Age of Sail till the end of World War II, basically. And big news have arrived us in War Thunder because the pre-World War I first generation Dreadnoughts are upon us, and well, that will be some interesting new content. However, what are they like? How will they fare against the last generation of heavy cruisers or World War II heavy cruisers? There are quite a lot of questions, and I think there, not just totally coincidentally, there is the Graf Spee in the background. So yeah, I think if we look at this picture here that has been kind of brought up by the community, these were the ships in the trailer about the new patch from Gaijin Entertainment for War Thunder. And we can see the Nassau, the Gengard, the Dante Alighieri, the Kawachi, and presumably the HMS Dreadnought. And well, first of all, welcome to the show, Drachinifel.
Hello. We are talking about the floaty, explodey things.
Yes. Well, actually, it has been a while since we talked about torpedoes and sea mines.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that, how long is that already? 2 years?
Probably something around that, I think.
How time flies by. And well, anyway, what do you think about that clash of technology?
It's going to be interesting. I mean, there is a noticeable gap there, given the balance of forces that are in War Thunder, which is that there doesn't appear to be the USS South Carolina. Fair enough, all of these are fairly hazed out, so there's a certain degree of interpolation to it, but enough of the profiles are recognizable to be pretty certain for all of the identities, and especially the fact there's no cage masks present means South Carolina definitely isn't there, which you'd think is a little bit odd, given that the US is a fairly major faction in War Thunder. But whether that's just because they wanted to go for a nice sort of 5-ship graphic, or whether it's being left out entirely, I kind of suspect they might actually be leaving it out entirely, and they may be working on how to come up with some other early US Dreadnought design that they can slot in.
So probably the US gets a second generation Dreadnought, do you think that?
Or maybe they'll get a, not a second generation, but the next step in their first generation. So that would be the Delaware class. And the reason I say that is actually sort of brings us on to looking at some of the ships they actually have here, which is that although they've obviously gone for the first Dreadnought battleship that each nation produced, which is good. But on the other hand, because of that, you've actually got two ships here which could really be classified as full second generation ships, which is the Dante Alighieri and the Gengard, because they were both laid down 3 to 4 years after Dreadnought and Kawachi, maybe about a year to two after Nassau. So you've actually got a very interesting split in capabilities. Gengard and Dante Alighieri are both going to have significantly greater broadsides than the other three. And I think this is why South Carolina's not there, because if you look at them all, Nassau, Kawachi, and Dreadnought, they've all got 8-gun broadsides. Technically, they've also all got 6-gun forward salvos, but hopefully you're not going to be charging head-on in them. But in the context of the game, obviously you can lose main gun mounts, and in the event that that happens, on those three, you can wheel about and present your other gun turret. Or if you are bracketed, if you've got a ship on either side of you, you've got at least a turret that can engage that side without having to swivel them all back round. Obviously, in that case, actually, Nassau despite its inefficient hexagonal layout, is actually best placed for that because it can bring to bear two unengaged turrets fairly quickly. But so, generally, yeah. Sorry, go on.
So let's just bring those ships into context. First of all, maybe a touch of historical context. Where does the Dreadnought myth come from? What was so special about HMS Dreadnought that kind of made the previous battleships or ships of, you know, with the biggest guns kind of irrelevant? And how did all the other nations catch up? And then maybe we'll talk just a little bit about their capabilities. So what are the guns? Mm-hmm. What are the reload? What is the speed? And obviously the armor. And I think then another very interesting part is how are those ships gonna fare against each other, but also versus the heavy cruisers? Because there are up to 30 years between their, you know, commissioning.
Yeah, so the reason why the Dreadnought is both the ship itself and the concept is such a radical advance is that gunnery in the early 20th century, and we're talking about like the first 5 years, goes through massive, massive steps. At the turn of the century, you've got the Spanish-American War, and in that war, you've got armored cruisers and pre-dreadnought battleships having a go at each other, but they're shooting at each other from a range of around about 1,000 to 1,500 yards, which is, by the standards of most 20th century naval combat, stupidly close. I mean, even in situations like Washington versus Kirishima in the Second World War, or the sinking of Blücher in the First World War, or even when Bismarck was completely crippled and Rodney was dancing around it, even in those circumstances, which are normally seen as point-blank range executions, even then, the ranges were about double that. So you're talking real point-blank range for naval artillery. But the hit rate in that war was on average around 1%, and most ships did less, which is just awful. I mean, we sort of, I'll put it in another context. Beatty at Jutland gets rightfully criticized for his ships not really being able to hit the broadside of a barn door a lot of the time. Even his ships, and bear in mind they're firing at 15 to 20,000 yards range at that point, do better than the ships in the Spanish-American War were doing at less than 10% of that range. But this comes right on the cusp of a massive revolution in gunnery. You have Admiral Sims in the US Navy, you have Admiral Fisher in the Royal Navy, and they are driving towards the idea of actually doing gunnery practice and bringing in new technologies such as range finders, and eventually, a little bit down the line, director controlled firing to try and extend the effective range of guns. This takes place, and so 3-4 years later, you have the Russo-Japanese War, which is again pre-dreadnoughts and armored cruisers versus each other. But now the battle ranges have expanded significantly. So not only are they engaging at 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 yards plus, they're actually hitting more often, despite the fact that the range compared to a war that was fought no more than 3 or 4 years before has gone up well over a factor of 5. And in the context of all of this, people are looking at and going, right, well, the previous paradigm where we had a few big heavy guns for knocking holes in the enemy ship and a lot of lighter guns for saturation fire, that may no longer hold true, because with the newer shells, the big guns really hit hard, the 12-inch and 11-inch guns that people are using. And at these kinds of extended ranges, you're now getting to a point where your secondary guns either can't shoot as far, that far, in the case of the smaller ones, or in some of the large ones, they can shoot that far, but director control and range finding is still a very limited technology, and so they can't have this allocated to every single gun. So bearing in mind the Russo-Japanese War accuracy levels we were talking about, if your secondary battery doesn't have range finders and central firing control, you're never going to hit a thing at 6,000 to 8,000 yards. So with all these secondary guns verging on useless, except for defending yourself against torpedo boats, everyone's thinking, well, what if we replaced some of those smaller guns with more larger guns so we can hit the enemy with heavier shells at very long range? And this starts a whole series of parallel developments. It all sort of kind of kicks off actually pre-Russo-Japanese War with an Italian chap called Cuniberti, who designs the what he calls an ideal battleship for the British Navy, which is an all big gun design. Then you have the Japanese cotton onto this idea because they're very heavily influenced by what the Royal Navy's doing or what they think it should do. So they start work on a ship with this kind of all big gun battery, which isn't actually the Koachi, it's the Satsuma, but they end up not being able to field it with its all big gun battery because they don't have enough of the big guns. The Americans are also getting in on the act with the USS South Carolina design, although this is massively constrained by Congress, who don't want them to build anything bigger than the existing Connecticut class, which, as I say, we'll come on to a bit later, I think, is why I haven't included it here. And then back in the UK, you have Admiral Fisher, who has been off and on pressing for the better part of 5 or 6 years to try and get an all-big gun design of some sort built. It wasn't always a Dreadnought-style thing. But he eventually gets permission, and he's somewhat aware that other nations have, you know, some ways jumped the gun on him, in at least in terms of designing a ship with a all-big gun layout. And so he turns around and says, right, well, we're going to exploit the massive industrial capability of British naval yards to build a ship really fast, but we're also going to incorporate a bunch of additional advancements into it. So not only does Dreadnought incorporate the all-big gun design, it also incorporates, as I said, the director firing and central battery control, which significantly improves the range and lethality of those guns. But it also brings in turbine propulsion, which allows the ship to travel at 21 knots, which for a capital ship of the time is virtually unheard of. And with a turbine propulsion, it can maintain that speed pretty much until it runs out of fuel. Whereas with the old vertical triple expansion engines, even though those ships are generally slower, normally 18 to 19 knots, with a few exceptions, they can't run at full speed for significant lengths of time before something starts breaking down or something starts gumming up. And on top of that, the level of vibration you get from a vertical triple expansion engine going full pelt in this era is quite awful. So you're not really going to get particularly brilliant long-range gun accuracy when your whole ship is vibrating like it's a washing machine that someone's thrown a brick into. And so Dreadnought incorporates all of these advances together and thus becomes almost like the HMS Warrior of her time. And bear in mind, Warrior marked the real big transition between the wooden ship of the line and the ironclad. Now, in Warrior's case, Gloire got in first, but Warrior came in and showed the paradigm for it. In this case, Dreadnought was pipped to the post in terms of being laid down by some of the ships we talked about, but actually, unlike Warrior, manages to launch and complete and commission ahead of everyone. And between that and the cool sounding name, it becomes the sort of the keystone. And now all of a sudden, various nations are left in something of a lurch, because for the Japanese and the Americans, who were already on their way towards building these kinds of ships, it's not a massive surprise. So they have, as we said, some designs in building, and the Japanese obviously quickly work up the Koachi design and get that underway. Other navies are caught very flat-footed. So some of them have just started or are about to start new pre-Dreadnought designs, or they're smaller navies and they don't have as much money, so they can't afford to jump on the latest trend immediately. And so it takes, I would say, probably 3 or 4 years for everyone to be on the same page in terms of the medium and large size navies in the 1900s, with various navies arriving in different times during that period. But considering that this is also in the middle of the naval arms race between Britain and Germany, it means that new ships of new designs are being laid down every year, And so Dreadnought, although it's incredibly powerful in 1906, by 1909, 1910, it's now been superseded in lethality by a number of larger, more heavily armed classes, and we're on the tipping point of seeing the first super dreadnoughts with even bigger guns being laid down. And this is where we have things like Gangut and Dante Alighieri come in, because they are ships that are built somewhat later down the line. But because of that, their designers were able to look at two or three sets of dreadnought-type battleships that have already been laid down and see what the incremental improvements are there, and then incorporate those into their own designs. And hence, their first, the Russian and Italian first dreadnoughts are actually what I would call second-generation dreadnoughts.
Okay. So was there also a little bit of improvement when it comes to the loading mechanisms and so-called the rate of fire?
Not immediately. Dreadnoughts 12-inch guns, for example, they're literally the same ones you find on the Lord Nelson class pre-dreadnoughts, to the extent that in order to complete Dreadnought faster, they actually went over to where Lord Nelson and Agamemnon were being built and stole their turrets. Because it was exactly the same thing. However, once dreadnoughts as a whole start entering service, there is opportunity then to improve the rate of fire, because one, these ships are a lot larger than pre-dreadnoughts generally, and so they've got a bit more room to play with. And two, technology is advancing quite quickly, so there's going to be natural improvements in that aspect anyway. And also three, because these ships carry lots of turrets, Dreadnought's got five turrets, Nassau's got six, then there's, because you're replicating the same mechanism over and over again so many times, there's a lot more scope to start looking at incorporating improvements into your ship design. Because if you're building, let's say, the Deutschland class pre-dreadnoughts, the immediate predecessors to the Nassaus, if you're building four ships, you're building eight turrets, which means you're building eight sets of loading equipment. But when you're building the four Nassaus, you're building 24 turrets with 24 sets of loading equipment. And if you've suddenly got that much stuff on order there, then because you've got so many more guaranteed sales, so much more greater profit, you can start looking at going, actually, we can reinvest some of this quite quickly into improving some of this technology for the next generation. Because the Helgolands, which would be the follow-ons to the Nassaus, basically replicate the layout only with 12-inch guns.
Okay. So what was the reload? Was it 30 seconds, 40 seconds, a minute? How did this change in battle? Just to get a good impression between the Dreadnought, the other capital ships that we're talking about.
Generally, the twin turrets, so that'd be Nassau, Kawachi, and Dreadnought, they could generally reload between one round every 30 seconds or one round every 40 seconds, depending on circumstances. So if you were firing at fairly close range and you were on fairly constant bearing, then with a good, well-trained crew and shell and charges ready to go, you could probably get a once every 30 second rate of fire quite comfortably. Whereas if perhaps the bearing's changing quite a bit and you're firing at quite long range, so the guns are elevated, they have to then be, at this stage, they have to be then brought down either horizontal or close to it to reload, and then obviously re-elevated. In those circumstances, your rate of fire is going to drop off, and obviously during battle, as well as your crew gets more fatigued, that's going to have an impact. And the other thing is the shell hoist system, because it's not quite as simple as the cartridges and the shells are in the magazines, get stuck on a lift and brought up into the guns. Most of these ships have shell handling rooms immediately below the gun turret, and as well as obviously rounds in the gun turret itself. So going into battle, a ship will generally have a stock of shells and charges, which it can pretty much fire as fast as it can possibly load them. But once those are exhausted, it's down to how quickly can the hoists bring those shells and cartridges up, and that may be longer than 30 seconds. But obviously, whilst you're firing off your initial load, you'll have some more coming up anyway. So the running into that kind of issue would usually involve you having to have fired 10, 12 salvos. And to be honest, if you're firing 10 to 12 salvos in a row consistently, and you still haven't achieved all that much, something's probably already gone horribly wrong. The other thing you have to consider, though, is that whilst your theoretical rate of fire would be around once every 30 to 35 seconds initially, most ships are not going to be firing at that kind of rate, because when you're firing at long range, so, and in the era of these ships, you're probably talking about 8,000 to 12,000 yards. It would be longer by the time of World War One, but these ships all predate that. So in the, say, 1908, 1910 period, at 8,000 to 12,000 yards, the shell has a flight time. So there's no point in trying to maximize your rate of fire too much, because you fire your gun, let's say the shell takes anything from 10 to 20 seconds, depending on exactly what range you're firing at, to actually land. So that's time where there's no point shooting, because you have no idea whether the shells have actually gone anywhere close to the target. You've then got to observe where they land. You've then got to feed all that information back down to your fire control computer. The fire control computer has to then calculate all those variables, compensate further because other things like your target's course and speed or your course and speed might have changed, spit out a new result for your guns to aim at. Then the guns have to be aimed at that point, and then you can fire again with a reasonable expectation that your shells, at least even if they don't hit, they might at least land somewhat closer to your target. And that whole cycle is probably longer than 30 seconds anyway. So the fact that you might have another salvo ready to go at the 30-second mark doesn't tend to help you too much in long-range combat, because chances are you don't actually know whether you're aiming in the right position at that point, which is why this was actually one of the other advantages of the Dreadnought-type design, because to get a decent amount of accuracy out of them, out of big guns, you need ideally a four-gun salvo, which is why a lot of pre-dreadnoughts had four guns. But if you fire your four guns, obviously on a pre-dreadnought, you've got to wait until they're reloaded before you can even think about firing again. Whereas all of these ships have minimum eight-gun broadsides, which means that actually you can fire two of your turrets, and then you can take knowing pretty much that you're not going to get a first-round hit, you can actually start to take aim for another set of values and fire your second set of turrets. So by the time both sets have reloaded, you now have two data points to compare to. And that means that for your next full salvo, you're going to have a lot more accuracy than a pre-dreadnought would have.
Very interesting. Two more things. I guess the speed of all those dreadnoughts is somewhere between 20 and 22 knots, something in that range.
Yeah, and yeah, I think Dante Alighieri might have been pushing the boundaries there a little bit, but yeah, generally, Dreadnought herself is 21 knots. Nassau is about 20, and then you've got, I think Koachi's around about the same, 20, 21 knots. And it goes on from there.
So they are not really speed monsters, but what about their armor? What kind of armor philosophy shared they all, or did they follow different principles? Distributed armor, all or nothing, came probably a bit later. But what kind of belt thickness and armor quality are we looking at?
So belt thickness varies slightly on these. Anything from the Italian Dante Alighieri is 10 inches, and it gets an extra knot of speed compared to Dreadnought for that, up to around about 12 inches. So Dreadnought herself, I can't remember off the top of my head, hang on. So the Bellerophon class, which follow on from Dreadnought, I know they carry a 10-inch belt, but I think they were thinned down. Yes, Dreadnought carries an 11-inch belt. Nassau, I think, is slightly more heavily armored. So we're talking about between 10 and 12 inches of armor generally.
Okay. So what was the, and this is the first comparison to a ship that we already have in the game, that is the Admiral Graf Spee, which is a very special design, very interesting history. If you guys are interested, he has, in this case, Drachinifel, has a very interesting video on the Admiral Graf Spee. And a very short video, but it's a bit longer than usual. It's not a 5-minute guide, technically speaking, where the history of this ship comes to a very interest or into an interesting format. Now, the Admiral Graf Spee also has 11-inch guns. They are also kind of World War One era-ish, but obviously then the firepower is improved here a little bit. We can see that on the wonderfully named 283mm Panzersprenggranate L4.4 APBC round has around 500mm of penetration against flat armor at point blank range, and roughly 360 at 10 kilometers and still 320 at 15 kilometers. So that is at this very moment, the strongest shell in the game when it comes to penetration, and also the bursting charge for an AP shot might be one of the biggest. And with 910 meters per second, it's definitely not on the slower side. So how do the guns of the pre-World War One first generation Dreadnoughts, you know, compare to this in terms of damage, in terms of penetration?
So the guns are going to be a little bit all over the place around Graf Spee's capabilities, because you've, I mean, the 12-inch guns, which are equipped on everything except for Nassau, they in and of themselves, obviously, they're slightly bigger linearly, but that means quite a significant increase in weight, and generally that's going to also mean a significant increase in bursting charge. Some of them, such as the Dreadnought herself, they, as a sort of national general trait, tend to have slightly larger bursting charges than the German shells did anyway. So for, say, Dreadnought's guns, and to be honest, probably Kawachi's guns as well, I would expect them to be, well, they are going to be a lot heavier, and I would expect them to do a lot more damage because they're going to be carrying a lot more explosive. Armor penetration, as I say, is going to be a bit all over the place, because Graf Spee's guns are very similar to the 11-inch guns that were equipped by German ships in World War One, albeit that they're an evolution on that, and bear in mind that there were several additional makes models of 11-inch gun past that equipped on the Nassau, which were equipped on various German battlecruisers. So its penetration values for the Graf Spee would be better than Nassau's, assuming that they model Nassau's guns as of the time it was in service in World War One. But the flip side to that is you've got the long barrel 12-inch guns on the Gangut class, and the Russian 12-inch gun is probably one of, if not the best 12-inch guns developed in the First World War. It has stupidly good penetration for the period, and so that is going to probably be well above the way it, if they're doing it in any way realistically, it's going to be much, much better at armor penetration than Graf Spee's guns are going to, is going to be.
So let's just calculate in the ballpark of 600, 650 millimeters, or even in excess of that.
Well, I can give you a direct comparison in 2 seconds. I'm just to get the particular statistics in front of me. So we've got the real sort of the real world, if you like, performance of Graf Spee's guns, which is what you've just mentioned there. And then we've got Russia, which is going to be, so the Russian guns on the Gangut class. So they have an armor penetration at just over 9 kilometers of 352 millimeters, 13.85 inches of armor. And then they've got 207 millimeters out to 18,000 meters.
Okay, so that's not too far off.
No, but I have a feeling, if I remember correctly, I have a feeling that actually the armor piercing values for the Grafspeis guns in game are slightly better than what they would have been in real life. But it's not dramatically so, but it's kind of an idealized condition as opposed to the World War One sort of real world figures. But to looking at that, have a look at the actual ammunition characteristics. So the real life bursting charge of the Grafspeis guns is just over 6.5 kilograms of explosive.
Mm-hmm.
The Russian APC round carries just under 13 kilograms of explosive.
So
it's got about double.
So what is, just in one sentence, how accurate are those ships if they have the ideal range? If both ships are just standing still in flat condition and the range is, let's say, 10 kilometers, how accurate are the guns? How wide is the dispersion, so to speak?
Again, it varies from ship to ship. So it also depends on what period they've modeled them in, because some of these ships did have accuracy issues when they initially went into service, but these were ironed out later on. And there's also obviously the quality of the fire control systems. But broadly speaking, most of these ships at, say, 10,000 yards, you're probably looking at, or 10,000 meters. I know they're two different ranges, but bear with me. but roughly the kind of 10 kilometer-ish bracket, you're probably looking at circular error of probability is probably around about 300 to 350 yards. So maybe about 250 to 300 meters.
So roughly a ship length.
Yeah, roughly for these ships, roughly a ship length, yes.
Okay. So let's now come to the armor protection in the shape of the steel quality. And there I want to draw the comparison between what the navies had in the Second World War for their heavy cruisers, including the Admiral Grafspee, and then obviously what kind of steel quality the dreadnoughts had and how they reacted to, you know, impacts.
Yeah. So armor steel quality by World War II, generally speaking, has gone up, as has certain formulations of trace elements in the armor, as has techniques for face hardening, but those improvements vary quite a bit across the board. And also, actually, when we're comparing battleships with cruisers, it gets more complicated again, because with some of these factors, they run in favor of certain types of armor at thinner dimensions and against them at thicker dimensions, and vice versa. So, for example, if you were talking about battleships, the way that British battleship armor was made, in terms of the actual quality of the material and the formulation of the various trace elements in the alloy, that had gone up massively. But the way that the face hardening was done worked very well for battleship grade thicknesses, but maybe not quite so much for cruisers. Whereas in the US, it was the other way around. The US battleship armor plate suffered somewhat from a few errors they made in basically making the hard face of the armor a bit too thick. But by keeping that same percentage of thickness all the way down, it actually meant their cruiser armor was considerably tougher than everybody else's. So there's all these sliding scale factors. To be honest, when you're back in World War One, it's actually a lot easier. Most most of the time everybody's armor is roughly of the same quality. There are some differences here and there, but actually nowhere near the level of difference between the best and worst quality armors in World War II.
How much does the strength of the armor plating percentage-wise go up? 5%, 10% between the Dreadnoughts and the heavy cruisers of World War II?
Quality-wise, again, it depends on the exact nation. You could have a situation where armor plate quality hasn't gone up much, if at all. It might be 3 to 5%, if that. You might have but on another nation's ships, you might have it where the armor quality's gone up by 25, 30%, possibly even more, depending on exactly what armor you're looking at. So it's going to be a little bit all across the board, but to be perfectly honest, none of the heavy cruisers or light cruisers from World War II that are in the game at the moment, yes, they're going to have technically superior armor quality generally. It's not going to make a massive difference if they get hit by an 11 or 12 inch shell.
Okay. So the question is, when it now comes to the gameplay, let's make a little bit of a jump finally. Let's say the two ships spawn, let's say, just for the sake of argument, 10 kilometers away from each other, and the battleship has obviously the massive alpha strike, the shells punch through the armor, do a lot of damage, but then a long reload and the ship is slow. So the cruiser probably has significantly higher rate of fire, gets 2-3 salvos out before the battleship can even reload, and then we can just assume it's a little bit of a battle between alpha strike and DPM. So what kind of damage can do 8-inch guns at the various different rates or ranges with their very different shell types to a Dreadnought? Is the Dreadnought all immune, or can it be beaten into submission, a death by 1,000 cuts?
At 10,000 meters, there is a decent possibility that the 8-inch guns on a World War II cruiser could probably do a fair bit of damage. It's unlikely, outside of maybe one or two gun designs, that you'd be able to punch through the battleship's belt armor, but you would have the ability to penetrate various other plates of armor on the ship, because you've got to bear in mind, being first generation Dreadnoughts, these ships' armor schemes are not all or nothing. They're going to have a main belt thickness, but they're also going to have an upper belt, which is thinner. They're going to have armor fore and aft, which is thinner. Potentially the turrets may or may not be thinner, depending on the ship in question. So all of those thinner plates of armor would be quite vulnerable to pretty much any 8-inch gun.
So
the 6-inch guns, maybe not so much.
Now, this is obviously one of those things from games in particular, but this is pretty excessive in its effectiveness. How much use you get out of from angling away from enemy fire in your cruiser and in your battleship? So how great's the difference in that aspect?
It will have some effect. It will improve the overall effectiveness of the thicker parts of your armor reasonably substantially. But to be perfectly honest, past about maybe 25, 30 degrees, you're not going to have all that much more increase in effectiveness. Because at that kind of angle, depending on how accurate the actual modeling is, not only is there a much greater chance of a ricochet for obvious reasons, but also if, as I covered in my recent video on shells, at that kind of angle, you also start to get the destruction of the armor-piercing caps on the shell's tips, which will compromise the shell's ability to penetrate. And once that occurs, any further increase in angle, like 45 degrees, 60 degrees, 80 degrees, well, if it's going to deflect it or stop it, it's going to deflect it or stop it. The fact that it's happening at 30 degrees or 80 degrees is rather irrelevant. In the thinner parts of the armor, again, once you get past maybe 30 degrees, I wouldn't really hazard that it's going to help you all that much, because one of the weaknesses when it comes to game design is that you've got these armor plates and they assume that they're kind of infinitely rigid and less penetrated. So if you take a 5-inch plate and you angle it at 45 degrees, you're like, oh, well, this has effectively 7 or 8 inches of thickness. And if you angle it at 80 degrees, you're thinking, oh, well, now this has an effective thickness of maybe 10 or more inches. So this is fantastic. That's not how it works in real life, because the impact of the shell on the metal, if it's a thinner plate, is very likely to flex and bend that metal anyway. And then, obviously, once it's bent, its angle is no longer true. And apart from the fact it's now probably loosened and much less able to resist the shell's flight anyway, it's also now bent in such a way that it presents a much thinner overall thickness to the incoming shell. One of the classic examples I try and use to illustrate that is, if you imagine, if you take a sheet of tin foil and you put it on a flat table and it's, say, 30 centimeters long, if you were to then take a pencil and try and simulate a very, very shallow angle glancing blow on that tin foil, maybe even run it almost along the table, theoretically, by game mechanics, even though that tin foil is a fraction of a millimeter thin, by game mechanics, a lot of the time that would say, oh, well, you're pretty much parallel to this 30 centimeter long strip, therefore trying to push your way through 30 centimeters of aluminium, which obviously you're never going to do with a pencil. But in actual fact, we all know what's going to happen. It's just going to bend and twist and ruck up and tear through the foil, because the foil is very thin and just can't resist that kind of pressure and movement. And on a slightly less dramatic scale, that's what happens with the thinner armor plates when they're hit by heavy shells. So yeah, the thicker parts of the armor will benefit from a certain degree of angling, but thinner parts shouldn't.
So,
but they might anyway, depending on the mechanics.
So you can kind of bring this together and just, you know, put it into the terminology of it gets overmatched.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it doesn't really matter how angled the armor plating is, the shell will just overpower it, just fall through like a rock through, I don't know, a sheet of paper.
Yeah, pretty much. The other thing that's going to be very interesting is that around about the time of these first generation dreadnoughts, a number of navies were experimenting with a kind of a halfway house between armor piercing and high explosive shells. And they were variously semi-armor piercing, common point capped, or CPC. Different people call them different things, but effectively what they are is that, as you know, you've got nose fused high explosive and base fused high explosive, and the AP is base fused as well. But some clever person around the time they were inventing the armor piercing caps for the armor piercing shells, they thought, well, what happens if we stick an armor piercing cap on a base fused high explosive round? And they ended up with a shell that had a bit more penetration than a normal high explosive round, nowhere near as much as an armor piercing round, but obviously carried a much bigger explosive charge. And the theory went that, well, we can use this to shoot through the thinner parts of a battleship's protection or a cruiser's protection generally, and deliver an absolutely colossal explosive charge. That then got refined into something that we would probably today call a proper semi-armor piercing shell. So that at that point probably having maybe 60 to 70% the penetration of an armor piercing round, but maybe 5 to 10 times the explosive. And if they model those, that's going to be very, very interesting, because if we looked at, say, the Gangut, and the Gangut's are always, I think, are going to be a bit of a weird one, because the Gangut's of all of these five ships have the thinnest armor protection. They're the only ones to have less than 10 inches armor protection, but they also have the best guns and the highest speed. They're going to be topping out at just over 24 knots.
So they are like glass cannons, basically.
They're going to be the most vulnerable to the high tier heavy cruisers, but they're also going to hit the hardest. But if they model them with the semi armor piercing shells, those things, in the Russians' case, have a bursting charge of 61.5 kilos of explosive.
Big oof.
So if you're sailing around in a cruiser that's only got a 3 or 4 inch armor belt, one of those will quite happily perforate through, except it's going to detonate inside with effectively the explosive power of being hit by half a broadside of normal armor piercing 12 inch shells, which in and of itself, so that's six guns. So I mean, you basically have one shell that's carrying approximately the explosive power of being hit by two full salvos of the Graf Spee. Which is not—it's not going to do kind things to a 10,000-ton cruiser.
Oh no, it doesn't. So there is one more aspect that is kind of flying above all ships: the menace in the sky aircraft. And this is then where ships are so much different from tanks and planes in that aspect. As normally in War Thunder, you have those tech trees. You know, you get the tanks and they get more armor, more speed, better guns, higher rate of fire. You get additional technology like stabilizers, high penetration shell types. You get autoloaders, thermal imaging, all the wonderful things of technology. And with planes, you know, higher, faster, and also more stuff to shoot at the enemy. And, you know, with bombers, bigger bomb load. And that obviously then brings us to one of the interesting facts, because in War Thunder, this is measured in the so-called battle rating system. So the numbers usually go higher, the higher in the tech tree the vehicle lies, or in this case, downwards. And, well, presumably, Gaijin will decompress once. Then we have the big cruisers at 6.0 and the Dreadnoughts at 6.0 or 6.3, maybe up to 6.7, we'll have to see. And they will encounter some nasty things. And just in the, you know, just to get into this, there are American planes with the wonderful Mark 13 44 torpedoes that can be dropped at over 500 kilometers per hour. Some Japanese torpedoes are equally nasty. Then we have the Soviets with their infamous P-8 that has a 5-ton bomb with a TNT equivalent of 5 tons, because the explosive is a little bit better. We have then also the absolute German overkill. That is the Heinkel 177A5 that has 3 PC-1400, aka the Fritz X, 3 of them. So you kind of can see the problem here. World War II cruisers have a lot of AA. Even the Graf Spee has some, you know, heavy AA and medium AA. You get the Prinz Eugen in its iteration as a 1945 ship has all the 40 millimeters and some quad or some flak feelings. So a lot of AA. Some Allied cruisers, or the majority of them, have proximity fuse, high explosive shells, and they are also faster, so more difficult to hit. That is probably the greatest weaknesses, one of the greatest weakness of those World War I dreadnoughts, because they have practically no AA.
Yeah, this is that's going to be the single biggest issue, I think, going forward, because a lot of these ships, when they were launched, aircraft weren't a consideration militarily at all. So in those cases, you're going to be looking at someone sitting there just going, we don't have any AA, period. Maybe they stuck a couple of machine guns on. But the thing is, even then, at best, with refits and such, like, at absolute best, you're going to be looking at maybe a couple of 3-inch guns, maybe 4 of the old World War One era 88 mils. And none of these ships, with the exception of Gangut, which later became some unpronounceable way of saying October Revolution, none of these ships survived the Washington Naval Treaty. So you're going to be looking at ships that basically have no AA defense, unless they do maybe October Revolution refit style. That would actually have a decent amount of AA. Not brilliant compared to some other World War II ships, but better than nothing. The rest of them are going to be literally, your AA, if you've got it at all, will inform you that there is an aircraft in the vicinity because it's open fire, and that's literally all you're going to get from it.
Just for people that might not come from War Thunder, this battle rating era is where in War Thunder jets begin. So in the worst case scenario, you'll engage the Arado 234B2, which can, in its worst case, deliver a single 1,000 kilogram bomb and two 250 kilogram bombs. So the one will penetrate deep into the ship, and the two smaller bombs will wreck the superstructure. So you can see that this is one of those very, very awkward implementations into War Thunder. But as I said, ships are in that case different to tanks and planes, as the World War One ships are very well capable of dealing with World War Two ships. And if you think about it, even if we go to the super dreadnoughts like Warspite, it had 15 inch guns. If you look into the future a little bit, it had 15 inch guns that forced, for example, relatively modern German battleships to abandon the attack. I'm talking here about the Queen Elizabeth or R class in general versus the Scharnhorst class, which was better that it had, higher speed, probably better armor, etc. But it just didn't have the gun firepower to deal with the enemies and effectively. And that is also one of those things where the guns of ships are the deciding factors in the ship-to-ship combat, whereas then other factors play very heavily against the old ships when it comes to dealing with aircraft. And one other thing is torpedoes. Now, I mentioned here bombs, and they will just cut through the deck armor like a hot knife through butter. Even if they don't, their massive bursting charges will deal heavy damage. But what about torpedoes? World War II ships had torpedo bulges, and they can probably deal with some of the lighter torpedoes. But what about dreadnoughts?
These early ships are basically going to have next to zero torpedo defense. Not that they didn't have torpedo defense when they were built. They had some, because mines and torpedoes were known to be a thing in the mid-1900s and thereafter. But when you look at, as some of the ships you mentioned earlier, like the Queen Elizabeth and the R's, those are built 6-7 years after Dreadnought. And those ships, by the time of mid to late World War One in the 1920s, are having big extra anti-torpedo bulges installed because their torpedo defenses are nowhere near adequate even by then. Even by the 1920s, these ships, several generations of design behind, whilst they might have some torpedo defense against some of the very earliest torpedoes against the kind of torpedoes they're likely to see in the game, no, they might as well not have any. Their only saving grace might be when it comes to aircraft assault, because, and it's been a while since I did air versus ship, but as far as I'm aware, a lot of the time people like to load out with relative many smaller bombs. There are some people who take fewer larger ones, but just for the chance of getting a hit, if you take many smaller bombs, there's a chance that these things will probably soak the damage, because a 250-pound bomb or 100-kilogram bomb or something like that probably isn't going to scratch much on something this size. Even though their deck armor's not massively anything to write home about, it's more than enough to resist something like that. But if someone's running around with, say, a 1,000-kilo or even maybe a 500-kilo bomb, if they get the right drop, that'll still do a number on these ships, unless you're absolutely unlucky enough to somehow manage to hit the belt armor.
Well, let me tell you, at this battle rating, there are enough bombers that are very agile, very fast, and carry not just a few, but quite many heavy bombs. And, you know, in the dark ages of free-to-play games, some people are not shying back from revenge suicide bombs. But that is, you know, the worst of cases. And...
well, it's not exactly out of keeping with World War II in some theaters of war.
Yeah, Japanese planes. Mm-hmm. But another thing is, I just can't imagine the carnage like a salvo of long lances into the enemy spawns will cause and just absolutely decimate those Dreadnought of first generation. I think that is also a clash of technology where, you know, all those big nasty Dreadnoughts with their heavy guns, heavy armor, just will fall victim to, yeah, a small destroyer of the Imperial Japanese Navy that just will happily throw around up to 16 torpedoes in two salvos, or 15 in the Shimakaze's case. So, yeah, those long lances, happy fun for everybody. So I just have to ask this question, because mm-hmm. games are different from books in that people have knowledge about what happened in history. Games just put vehicles in unusual scenarios, not just in the clash of technology, but also the combat targets, etc. So how interesting is this clash of technology and different design approaches, or ships that would have never met themselves in their lifetime? How interesting is that for you to see in a game like War Thunder that has a, let's be fair, semi-realistic approach?
I mean, I suspect it's going to give a lot of fuel to people trying to do these alternate history scenarios. I think it could be very interesting. It could, however, also go horribly wrong. I know when we've talked about War Thunder privately in the past, we've talked about problems with some of the map sizes where the cruisers can just open fire on you from the other side of the map the minute they spawn. These ships will be able to do that and more. It's you open the range, you could open the range of the maps up and they'll still be able to open up on you pretty much instantly. And to be perfectly honest, with some of them they might, and certainly on some of the maps, they might even be able to open up with on you with a secondary battery from spawn as well. So I think you're gonna need to revise the maps either to be much larger, or you're gonna have to put some rather chunky islands or something in between the spawns in order to ensure that it's not just a case of Dante Alighieri has spawned, the other team has died.
Okay, kind of a realistic scenario when it comes to War Thunder. So I will be obviously on the dev server when it when it opens up, when we have a first look at the probably stunning 3D models, when it comes to the mechanics, the penetrations, and then we can dig a bit more into how accurately those ships are implemented, how accurately the rate of fire and armor values are, etc., etc. So this is for a future period. I'm always a fan of bigger guns in the game, but sometimes you have to step back a little bit for, you know, the gameplay's purpose. And what would be an alternative when it comes to you? Because when it comes to the Second World War, with the exception of the Deutschland class, like the Admiral Graf Spee, you had your 8-inch heavy cruisers, and then battleships began. And against those, the heavy cruisers have practically no chance, because they have more guns, even bigger guns, you know, from 14, 15, 16, 18.1-inch guns in the Yamato's case, and obviously insane secondaries, and yeah, even thicker armor, faster. They don't have the disadvantage of AA. So when it comes to this scenario that Gaijin is about to build up, what would be your alternative to kind of close this performance gap?
To be honest, I'd actually even skip a generation in battleship. Well, I'd do one of two things. I would either skip a generation in battleships, or I would split these things down the battle ratings with a lot more in intensity. So rather than the current system, which, okay, fair enough, there are some higher tier destroyers and torpedo boats and such, but generally speaking, if you're at the high tier, you're going to be in the big ships, and if you're in the lower tiers, you're going to be in the smaller ships. I'd actually, now that you're getting all sorts of classes, I'd actually maybe start looking at doing it a bit more like they've done tanks and planes. So obviously with the tanks and planes, you've got, like, I don't know, tank destroyer, heavy tank, light tank, or fighter bomber, medium bomber, heavy bomber, that kind of stuff, and they all progress down their own lines. So you can have a battle rating 2 heavy bomber, or you can have a battle rating 7 fighter kind of thing. I'd look at doing that for warships, and then these ships could go down near the bottom tier, maybe like battle rating 3 or something, for battleships. And then if you want to bring these things in at the top tier to tangle with those World War II heavy cruisers, you'd have to bring in something different, something a little bit bigger to give something like a fair engagement. So I would suggest, as your entry tier, maybe something like the World War I refits, the modernizations, and see where that can take you. Now, obviously, you're either going to have to interpret that somewhat for some nations, because the Germans, for example, they don't have anything other than a refitted pre-Dreadnought in terms of their World War II era, World War I representatives. But maybe you could maybe substitute in the Yavuz Sultan Selim, the ex-Goeben, in its World War II guise. Because that's obviously a Moltke class battle cruiser, but refitted. So you could maybe put that in, and maybe put Conte di Cavour, the next generation of Italian battleships, but in its modernized form. The Japanese would be a bit more difficult, because the least powerful thing you'd have at that point would either be a refit Kongo or a Fuso, which might be pushing it a bit. With the Americans, you could put something like a refitted Texas in, and I'm sure that would be very popular. The British, you could put a refit QE or... Actually, there's quite a few options there, because with the British, you can put in a full refit QE like Valiant, a modernized but not quite all the way, like Warspite, or something like Barham or Malaya, which are kind of 1920s modernized, And the same with the R class. There's some of the R class were only just about had some modernization in the 20s, and then you've got Royal Oak on the other end, which was almost but not quite up to the level of Warspite in some of its refit. I'd have those as your entry level. We're going to fight the heavy cruisers ships.
Yeah, so that would be kind of then trying to make it equal with the anti-air threat.
Mm. Yeah, because all of those ships would have significant anti-aircraft batteries. And the key point of using the refit World War One ships is that there will at least there'll be a thing that they'll have there where they're not as good at as the cruisers, which will be speed. Because obviously they're going to have bigger guns, they're going to have more armor, but they'll be slower. So if you're in a heavy cruiser, you can at least, or anything else for that matter, to be perfectly honest, you can at least run away. Whereas if you went full tilt on and maybe tried to put in a Scharnhorst or a Bismarck or please no Yamato, or even, yeah, and King George V Vanguard, Littorio, that kind of stuff, those ships are going to have similar or close enough speeds to the heavy cruisers and everything else that you can't even run at that point.
Yeah. So basically, when it comes to War Thunder, the experience so far in Naval Forces is that it's about capture points. And without the assistance of a spotting system like in World of Warships, the ships are spotted and rendered at all times. Island cover is mostly scarce, except in the more close confined areas of the patrol boats, where big ships take too long to get in the first place to make a difference. So I think that the games will still be decided by patrol boats, which is, you know, pretty much the opposite of what you would think, because, you know, in terms of naval forces or in terms of naval combat, up until the mid of the Second World War, the one who had the most big guns usually had a decisive advantage if everything was more or less equal. And I see that Gaijin tries to implement them in a way that they begin, let's say, with light, like they did with the light cruisers. You know, you go from the USS Trenton to the USS Raleigh to the USS Atlanta, Cleveland, and Brooklyn. Then you start with the heavy cruisers, in this case, the Pensacola, Portland, and Northampton, with probably more heavy cruisers coming. And then they begin the next rank, rank 6, with the pre-World War I Dreadnoughts, then second generation, third generation, super Dreadnoughts, and whatever you wanna call the ships afterwards, and that then will be a fight. So I guess the picture that I draw here is that it will be super imbalanced, and you're sitting in your premium Prince Eugen, and suddenly, let's say 8, 10, 12 kilometers away from you, a World War One Dreadnought pops up, and you feel like in a severe disadvantage. But that is just true for the coming patch. And in two, mm-hmm. three patches, then those ships have to feast on the cruisers while they can before they get just pounded into oblivion by, let's say, super Dreadnoughts. The community in War Thunder has always asked for bigger guns, and now they get them. Let's see what the community will have to say about the way that Gaijin will implement them, and I hope that Gaijin makes a drastic overhaul of the map sizes, the spawn points, the island cover, the objectives, and also many other things that will make the fight not so nice. But anyway, big guns is not everything. There are so many other factors going in as well. We will be smarter when it comes out, when we, as I said earlier, will see the stuff on the dev server and then on the live server. And then, we can play some battles, and then you can tell me how you kind of think of this design choice and also the experience. Because while it might then not be 100% historically accurate in terms of the ships shooting at each other, But again, one of the very spicy questions, let's put it that way, is what if? And I think this is where, free-to-play titles like World of Warships, and in this case, War Thunder, can just create very interesting scenarios. Anyway, I think we've talked quite a bit. We could talk literally hours upon maybe even days about every single aspect. To all the viewers of this video, you will find obviously multiple links in the video description down below to some of the ships where there are 5-minute guides from Drachinifel, also the link obviously to his channel. And well, then there is just this to say, thank you for joining me in this awesome conversation, and anytime soon again, hopefully.
Well, we can have a bit of a deeper dive into this once they're out, and we see what exactly, what spec, what year, etc., that they've put them into. We can maybe come back and have a look, maybe in more detail, at the individual ships, because I mean, obviously, my 5-minute guides try and cover the entire operational history of a class in 5 minutes, but this will maybe afford us an opportunity to go into a little bit more detail on the specifics of each ship, and also when I say when we can work out what year they've modeled them in, it will also be quite interesting to point out where the advances were going to come later in their careers, or where bits have been added compared to their launch, which will hopefully give a bit more context.
One final thing for the amusement. When it comes to your let's call it 5-minute guide approach on the Nassau, I highly recommend everybody to listen to that one because that is fun.
Yes, it is a ship that makes me very angry.
Okay. So, that's it for today. Thanks for watching. Thanks for listening. You guys, please make sure to check out Drachinifel's awesome YouTube channel. There is significantly more stuff about whatever your heart's desire, from the Age of Sail to the, as we call it now, pre-Dreadnought era, Dreadnought era, up to and including the end of World War II shipping stuff. That's it for me today, and we'll see each other on the waves of War Thunder.